Winter's worst. When a snowstorm hits, gravel roads are far from a priority. See how one rural Iowa family is preparing to be snowed in for days.
Survivor. A broken hip was only the start for this little guy. See how he made it through a blizzard, a lack of food, and nearly 5 months on his own.
Just one more year. The clock is now ticking on Des Moines Gateway School. Why the majority of board members say closure is necessary, and what it means for the school's 170 students. The news begins now in high definition.
From WHO HD, Iowa's high definition leader. This is Channel 13 News at 10.
They're hypocrites, saying one thing and then meaning the other.
Some students and parents aren't very happy tonight after the Des Moines School Board voted to shut down a middle school. Good evening, I'm Erin Kiernan.
I'm Dan Winters. Thank you for joining us tonight. After a month of sit-ins and protests, board members decided tonight to close down Gateway School.
And it isn't sitting too well with parents or students. Erin Brilbeck has the story first on 13.
We're going to take care of our children, okay?
It's a decision that left some parents and students at Gateway Middle School in tears. By a close 4-3 vote, the Des Moines City School Board decided to close the school. Those opposed to the decision said there's no reason for it.
Reasons for closing the school would be two. Number one, a district's fiscal crisis, and number two, a school's failure to perform. And I guess for Des Moines Public Schools, it's fortunate that Gateway doesn't present either of those.
About 170 students will be impacted by the decision to close down the International Baccalaureate, or IB, school. IB schools focus on teaching with a heavy emphasis on applied instruction. Some board members argued that's what all Des Moines schools should do, and rather than spend more money to accommodate a relatively small number of students, board member Connie Bozen believes the cash should be spent benefiting all students.
And you know, we talk about all these dollars now. All of a sudden, the district finally has money. Well, thank goodness we finally aren't in a crunch. But I say before we have a program that's duplicative to what we can offer in the other middle schools, I'd like to fill like at least 15 positions of teachers that are still from our arts, PE, and music that are traveling between schools.
Parents and students say they're disappointed with the decision.
To close a school after 3 years when it is academically successful and when there are no financial issues is really, can't understand it.
It doesn't make any sense whatsoever to close the school. There are no good reasons for it. It's just plain stupid.
In Des Moines, Erin Brilbeck, Channel 13 News.
With tonight's vote, Gateway will close down after the 2013-2014 school year.
And members of Iowa's House of Representatives finally approved an allowable growth rate for schools. It's in the form of an amendment to the school reform bill that they've been debating late into this evening. It's part of Governor Branstad's education reform plan. The House unanimously set allowable growth at 2% for the next 2 years. The Senate approved a 4% increase for the next 2 years. Governor Branstad had asked lawmakers to do away with the allowable growth model and instead replace it with a set funding amount. The House bill will give teachers a smaller starting pay increase than what Branstad had asked for. The Senate has not begun to debate education reform. A Senate subcommittee did approve a plan to give $11 million to counties to pay for mental health costs. The state is currently in the middle of a transition to a regional mental health network. Eventually, it will save counties money and coordinate services, but during this transition period, budgets are running very short, and this money is supposed to get them through until June 30th.
Legislation is being introduced this week that supporters say will help destigmatize HIV, the virus that causes AIDS. Channel 13's Sonia Heitzhusen has the story, new at 10.
To wear a GPS ankle bracelet.
In 2008, prosecutors charged Nick Rhodes with criminal transmission of HIV, even though he practiced safe sex and his partner did not contract HIV.
You are a very, very, very bad person.
Rhodes was sentenced to 25 years in prison and placed on the sex offender registry.
We have a situation in Iowa where the law was written in a way that did not differentiate between exposure and transmission.
Senator Matt McCoy wants to change that. He's introducing a bill he says will modernize the law and recognize that people with HIV can lead healthy lives.
We wanted to destigmatize HIV. We have a separate statute for HIV, but we don't have a separate statute for tuberculosis or other contagious diseases.
Health advocates say the current law also discourages HIV testing. The saying goes, if you take a test, you risk arrest.
Because why would I want to know my status? Why would I want to be involved with public health when there's this law on the books where I could face criminal prosecution?
This at a time when Iowa leads the nation in late diagnosis of HIV. At initial diagnosis, 47% have already progressed to full-blown AIDS.
That's not good because those people are a risk to everyone in our society, heterosexual and homosexual community.
Opponents of the bill believe everyone should disclose their HIV status to their partner. McCoy doesn't disagree, but he says a law requiring them to do so leads to a false sense of security.
The assumption is that, well, if they are positive, they've got to tell me. Well, that really isn't the case.
Sonia Heitzhusen, Channel 13 News.
Now, the bill would still allow for prosecution of people who intentionally or recklessly transmit HIV. Rhodes, one of 25 Iowans prosecuted under the current law, is appealing his conviction.
Well, winter storm is still right on track to hit Iowa this Thursday. Chief Meteorologist Ed Wilson says we need to get ready for it now. Hey, Ed, what's the latest on this thing?
Dan, not a big change from yesterday or even earlier in the day. We've been tracking the same situation, and it looks like it will fill in all the blue counties that you see here that are watches, and especially just to the west of us, winter storm warnings out there already. And I do think that much of the state of Iowa by this time tomorrow night will be under a warning. The watch that we are talking about starts early Thursday morning. So I want to take you there and show you the timeline of our rain and snow path. The rain and snow mixing just to the south of us, but all snow here as we go through the day Thursday. It's going to be an ongoing event all the way through Thursday, even into early Friday. And these totals we showed you earlier, still staying right on track. 7, 8, 9 inches here in the metro. As you go just to the south and west, though, it ramps up to the 12, even 16, 15 inches of snow. Southwestern Iowa, I think there'll be some locations that will top out around 20 inches in southwestern Iowa. That's going to be a large portion of Nebraska and Kansas as well. Wind will come along with that, but before that, we have the calm and the cold. 9 by midnight, 3 tomorrow morning, and by noon tomorrow, we're only going to creep back up into the teens. It's going to be a chilly Wednesday, and then it is going to be a day of storm team coverage. For Thursday, we'll have our meteorologist here ready to go for you.
Buckle up. This is a numbers game, isn't it?
It is. It is, and it's very much the track of that storm. Any farther to the north, it would cut our storm totals down significantly. It does look like it's going to stay in Missouri.
All right, we'll see what happens. Thanks, Ed. Mm-hmm.
So with at least a foot of snow on the way, western Iowa communities are finalizing their plans for digging their towns out. Crystal Kastner has the story from Greenfield.
We got stuff inside. We usually got canned stuff.
James Carroll and his family have to be prepared.
Usually here it drifts down by the stop sign, so if it gets blowing pretty good, we usually get stuck in.
Living out here with just gravel roads to reach their home, it's not unusual for the Carrolls to be snowed in for days.
2 or 3 days.
And with a predicted 12 inches of snow headed their way, it could happen again. Just a few miles away, Greenfield's main drag is preparing for business as usual.
For the most part, no. Everybody keeps going.
Ryan Whistler is expected to be at work on time on Thursday, no excuses, ready to face the inevitable crowds.
The diesel has frozen and they're looking for something to thaw it out, or their car's not heating up properly, or their wiper blades don't work.
But Whistler says he isn't worried, thanks to the preparations done by these guys. City crews only have 2 plow trucks.
We run one truck behind the other one. That way we can do the center of the street and the curb at the same time.
And 5 crew members. But they've got a plan.
We have a route set. That way we don't have to backtrack a lot, and we do it in one pass.
In Greenfield, Crystal Kastner, Channel 13 News.
In addition to local crews, the DOT already out pre-treating roads to make the plowing easier.
Today, first responders were called out to a multi-car accident in the middle of a blizzard. That's a fake accident in a pretend blizzard. The Iowa Department of Public Safety held a demonstration today of a new nationwide wireless network. It's dedicated solely to first responders. With their own separate network, first responders won't have to compete with crowded commercial networks during severe weather. That gives them a clear line of communication to get to the people who need help.
We had law enforcement, we had ambulance, we had fire, we had Department of Transportation. All of these entities responded to this activity today. Well, they were able to share the information.
Iowa is getting around $2 million from the federal government to develop this system here. It's still 3 to 5 years away from becoming a reality.
The FBI is asking for your help to identify two people who may be related to a child sexual exploitation investigation and have Iowa ties. These are pictures of the men taken from images found on the internet relating to that investigation. Authorities believe the men may have an Iowa connection because of something else in those images. This t-shirt with the words New Market Basketball on it. Now, authorities aren't sure if the shirt is referring to New Market, Iowa in the southern part of the state or one of 10 other new markets across the country. The images also show a house with yellow siding and that above ground swimming pool in the image to your left. If you recognize either of the men in those pictures, the shirt or the house, you're asked to contact the FBI at 1-800-CALL-FBI.
A Des Moines woman is safe and on her way back home tonight after her family reported her missing last week. Jessica Pratt's loved ones were worried after she failed to return from Mardi Gras in New Orleans. Today, Pratt showed up at a New Orleans police station in good health. Her family says she's flying home to Des Moines tomorrow to be reunited with her three children. New Orleans police say there's no foul play involved with Pratt's disappearance, and they would not explain why she was gone for so long.
A Marshalltown couple is facing charges for allegedly capitalizing on a bank's error. The Times-Republican Online is reporting that a bank mistakenly deposited $13,000 into the bank account of Michael and Kelly Anthony. Marshalltown police say the couple quickly withdrew the money and spent it before the bank could retrieve it. The two are now charged with second-degree theft.
Well, tomorrow we'll find out more about a plan to bring another casino to the Des Moines Metro. Developers want to build a casino, hotel, and event center north of Norwalk near the Highway 5 bypass. A group of people calling themselves Warren County Citizens for Good Jobs say they will share some of those details. They're holding a news conference tomorrow afternoon. We'll share that with you at 5 and 6.
It's already been a great month at Southeast Polk High School.
Now, last week, the wrestlers brought home state duels and team trophies. Tonight, the girls' basketball team had a chance to punch their ticket to state. But the Ames Little Cyclones were standing in their way. Keith shows us who came out on top.
And after 4 months wandering the metro, Garrett finally has a place to call home tonight. Find out where the runaway terrier's travels took him and where he's sleeping tonight.
From WHO HD, Iowa's high definition leader, you're watching Channel 13 News at 10.
If you think you've had a tough winter, wait till you hear about what Garrett's been through. He was nearly killed by a car and almost euthanized at a shelter, and that was before things got interesting. Heinz 57 Rescue is a no-kill shelter in DeSoto that takes on the hopeless cases that others won't.
But in this case, that dedication to animals led the shelter's volunteers into more than 4 months of worry and frustration. Andy Fales has the story. It's new at 10.
When Amy Hines rescued 19-pound Garrett from a raggedy shelter in Kansas, he was just hours away from being euthanized.
He was at the shelter just sitting there with a broken pelvis, not getting any care.
Come on, Garrett.
She healed him at her shelter in DeSoto and then sent him to a foster home to regain the rest of his strength. His first day there, he slipped his collar on a walk and was gone. Hines wasn't contacted until that night.
If you can get out there immediately, you have a good chance of seeing where he went. But the next step is to just paper the area with flyers, which we did.
The flyers brought calls right away. Garrett was seen near the Merle Hay Cemetery. Then he headed north. Someone saw him near the skating rink on Meredith, then at Hyperion Golf Club. Hines searched Camp Dodge and got reports from as far north as the mile-long bridge. She was determined.
From the minute I tell a shelter that I will take a dog, I'm responsible for that dog.
But by then, the snowstorm and bitter cold had hit. It seemed Garrett's long road had ended near Sailorville.
The last place anybody spotted him was in a cornfield up there. And then we didn't hear anything for almost a month.
Rescue volunteers maintained a ray of hope. Garrett had stayed alive for 3 months on his own.
He knew where to find food, obviously, knew where to find shelter. So I don't know, maybe he did that in his life before he ended up in the shelter in Kansas.
2 weeks ago, Linda Fetters looked out her front window.
I knew that was him.
She'd seen one of the flyers, and she called Amy Hines.
I called Sue, and I said, you know, somebody thinks Garrett's in Pleasant Hill.
Fetters followed his tracks through the snow, along fence lines, and through parking lots and yards.
There were two boys, and they were standing by the front door, and I said, have you seen a little scruffy-looking dog? And they said, you just missed him. He's 10 minutes ahead of you.
Over the next 10 days, she and Sue Strom would search for Garrett, even see him from time to time. But they couldn't catch him.
When dogs are on their own like that, they get into a crazy mindset where they're just surviving.
They set box traps for him.
And then we caught a cat, and then another cat, and then a possum, big possum.
But never Garrett.
It was getting very hard to sleep at night.
Last Friday, Fetters left the trap out all night. She checked it at 6 a.m.
I hear this little growl, and it didn't sound like a coon. And so I bent over and I was like, well, hello. And he was just like, where you been?
Over 4.5 months in an Iowa winter, Garrett had survived on roadkill, traveling from the northwest corner of the metro to the far east side. Fetters decided immediately to keep him. An incredible journey.
I think Linda's his angel, and it was just a matter of time for him to get over here.
No one knows why he did it or how he pulled it off, but Garrett's road ended at the home he's never had. And that's all that really matters. In Pleasant Hill, Andy Fales, Channel 13 News.
Look at that face. Garrett's new home has nearly an acre of land surrounded by a very secure fence. You can learn more about A. Hines 57 Pet Rescue on their website, ahines57.com.
What a great organization. If Linda hadn't scooped him up, I was thinking, oh, I'll take him.
Yeah.
Garrett.
Oh, sweet.
You can have the cats or the possum or any number of things she caught.
She caught a lot of stuff.
Garrett is a blessed little puppy. That's great. We have a big storm. Thank goodness Garrett's going to be safe before this one hits on Thursday. I'll show you the totals in a minute. Welcome back. Big storm still on track. Thursday is the day. That's where we're going to see most of the snow, and it's going to start mid-morning Thursday and last through early Friday. Clear and cold until then. It's going to be dry and calm tomorrow. But that winter storm already has watches attached to it here in Iowa, but warnings just to the west. Temperatures are dropping tonight into the single digits. Marshalltown, Ames, Fort Dodge, 13 in Pella, our favorite number right here, 13 downtown. And we still have wind chills below zero tonight. So please make sure you bundle up. This is going to be a cold start tomorrow morning, obviously. And we are going to see dangerously cold conditions in many areas of northern Iowa. They still have a wind chill advisory for about the northern two tiers of counties. 13 is our current temp, and our dew point now is down to zero. We watch that temperature to see how low our actual temperatures will be going. We still have a gusty wind, 17 to 25 miles per hour, just the last hour. It's clear right now. We're waiting, as I said, for this storm. It's going to be packing a punch. It's finally moving in off of the coast, the west coast of the United States, picking up more snow, the Sierra Nevadas, and now it'll be our turn by Thursday. This pressure system, that big storm center, is running right across Missouri on a line that usually leaves us with quite a bit of snow. If it were right over St. Louis, that's when we usually get bombed on here. We call it the St. Louis bomb because that big pressure center lines up a lot of moisture, brings it in, and it will continue to do that. Even though it's farther north of Missouri, we're still going to see a heavy snow band by 1 o'clock in the afternoon Thursday. A lot of superintendents of schools trying to figure out exactly the timing on this one, of course, let their kids go to school. I think a lot of the schools are going to be in session, may have to do an early dismissal. 4 o'clock in the afternoon Thursday, heavy snow continues, and right through the evening and overnight into early Friday, this is going to come with quite a bit of wind. So with that 8 inches of snow, up to a foot of snow, even 16 to 20 inches of snow in southwestern Iowa, we're going to see the wind blowing that snow around. And with lesser amounts to the east, everybody's underneath the watch. It actually starts Thursday morning and goes until Friday morning. So here we go. Off to the cold air tonight. 3 degrees, that low, blustery wind, 10 below the wind chill factor in some cases, right here in the metro by tomorrow morning. 25 tomorrow, mostly sunny. And then the clouds move in tomorrow night. Thursday is the day for that a very strong storm, and travel by the afternoon is going to be very difficult. In fact, right around the noon hour, I think we'll be under some of the heaviest snow that'll last through the evening drive time. 7-day forecast dries us out on the weekend. Another chance for a couple inches of snow in a different consistency. This one on Monday is going to be that sloppy kind of stuff that we had right before Christmas. Not as much snow, of course, but this snow that we'll see on Thursday has that fluffy consistency, so the visibilities will be down. Driving, as I said, going to be terrible.
Wow.
Well, all of this is happening, you know, because we've said the words state basketball.
Southeast Polk doesn't care about the snow. They're too excited. Nothing beats winning state, but the night you make state, that's close, or so I hear. Ames Southeast Polk winner goes to the well, third quarter. Here come the little Cyclones. Great ball movement. Bailey Jackson inside. Kevin Jackson loves it. Then it's Molly Sanders strong to the hole. Ames by one after three. Fourth quarter, Rams answer. Annie Penquite steal and lay in. Then Penquite strikes again, this time behind the arc. Southeast Polk feeling it. Future Drake Bulldog Caitlin Engel puts it away. The deep three, and the Rams are headed to state 54-46 over Ames. And that looks like it feels good.
There's been a lot of pressure, I think, on us because the expectations were so high, and we're coming back and we're playing our ball now, so we're ready.
You know, they battled back, and I think they're stronger, and you know, they faced adversity and they've overcome it, and they want it bad and they work hard, and you know, I can't ask for a better team.
Dowling taking on Council Bluffs Abe Lincoln. You could bet the Maroons played with a Spalding TF 1000. Channel 13 meteorologist Jerry Ann Ritter on hand to watch her brother-in-law. He coaches the visiting Lynx. He needed Jerry Ann at guard. It's all Dowling. Audrey Faber, easy turnaround inside. And then outside, it's Katie Mock, three from the corner. Dowling cruises to state 53-30. Also headed to girls' state. Keep the reserved parking spots for the Des Moines East and Ankeny buses, both winners tonight. Boys District, North Polk and Des Moines Christian. Lions with a great first half. Noah Hart, easy two inside. Des Moines Christian up six at the break. All Comets after that. Logan Vanderplatz, layup off the steal. North Polk advances 59-39. Winter storm Fast and the Flurious claims its first postponement. Thursday's Iowa-Nebraska basketball game in Lincoln rescheduled for Saturday. First weather-delayed game for Iowa in 6 years. At Missouri State, another win for the red-hot UNI Panthers, 69-63. If ISU played all home games, the Cyclones would rank top 10. Among the teams Iowa State defeated at Hilton Coliseum, the Baylor Bears. ISU beat the Bears by 8 2 weeks ago. Rematch tomorrow night in Waco, Texas. ISU needs a road win.
I think the biggest thing, we've been giving up too many easy baskets late in games. We get a 5-point lead with a minute and a half left, and the team comes down and gets an uncontested layup. You can't give teams easy baskets like that.
Clones and Bears playing for fourth place. Eric Campbell is out at Iowa and in Montreal. Campbell takes a job as receivers coach for the CFL's Alouettes. The Harlem Shake is officially out of control. We've seen Iowa State fans and Cy shake. Kansas basketball players, they did the Harlem Shake in the KU locker room. And Waukee High School students showed the shake after a girls' basketball game. Now, a washing machine. It's calm at first, then the bass and a brick kicks in. And look at that washing machine do the Harlem Shake. It's somebody, everywhere.
Somebody else is supposed to join the dance, though.
Well, the
like some other appliances.
Did the shake,
sometimes,
yes.
Sometimes you do, and people don't join the dance.
Yeah. Happened last night.
Sound familiar? We'll be right back. Thanks for joining us. Good night.